Let's take our Bibles this morning and turn to Luke chapter 1. Luke's Gospel chapter 1, we're reading at verse 39. Let's hear the word of God in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In those days, Mary arose and went in haste into the hill country to a town in Judah, and she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed in a loud voice, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed." And there will be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. That was a deliberate change. And there will be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. Well, we began this series on the first Sunday of Advent by mentioning a popular song, "Christmas is the most wonderful time of the year." And I know you know the song because you can't escape it if you've been in a store for the last 8 weeks. However, I suggested that for Christians, in fact, the song should probably go like this: "Christmas is the most theological time of the year," because you really don't get any higher theology than you get at Christmas time. Higher even than Easter, this is the highest pinnacle of theological thinking that you can do. So if you've survived these past 4 weeks and this morning, you'll be fine. Whether you understand it is irrelevant, because even those who are theologians in terms of theology proper, that's their job. They don't grasp it either. They're the first people to say that when it comes to talking about God and about God becoming man at Christmas, you have to start with the word incomprehensible. You have to start there. And we're going to see that again this morning. So let me just summarize where we've come so far. We started in John chapter 1 with John's account. He starts outside of time. He starts outside of creation before there's anything. He begins there when the Word is with God and the Word was God. And then he describes the coming into the world of the Word, that is, the Son of God. The Word became flesh. Matthew and Luke particularly, fleshes out what it means to become flesh. And what we've learned as we looked secondly in the second week at the announcement of Gabriel to Zechariah that she was going to have a son, and that her son would be the messenger who would prepare the way for the coming of the Lord God of Israel himself. We now come to the story of Mary. We saw last time how the angel came to Mary and announced to Mary what was going to happen. And Mary responds by giving her yes to what the angel has spoken. And things were then left hanging, as it were. And the key thing that we learned in all of those sermons so far is that this one who's coming into the world, and this one who's going to be born of the Virgin Mary, is the Son of God. And if you have been in Bible studies, perhaps, and you've read some of the literature for Bible study groups, you may have read something like this, that this phrase, Son of God, is used in a variety of ways in the Bible. It's used of Adam. Adam was the son of God. Israel is called the son of God. Angels are called the sons of God. The kings of Israel are called the sons of God. And now Christians are called the sons of God. And usually that's a preamble for saying that when this phrase, the Son of God, is used of Jesus, it's merely designating in a human way his role as Israel's Messiah. Now, if you've read that, I want you to now jettison that from your thinking. Because as we read the scripture very closely, we find that when this title is used of Jesus, it marks him out as unique and different. It differentiates him from anyone who's ever had the phrase Son of God as a title in the history of the world. How is it going to happen? The conception of Jesus in Mary's womb was to happen not in any human way, but by the overshadowing of the Holy Spirit. In other words, the mysterious work of the glory of God that was present at creation is going to be present at this new creation in Mary's womb. And it is the power of the Most High and the presence of the Holy Spirit that determines the manner of Jesus' existence in a human nature and points us to the identity of the one who is so conceived in Mary's womb. Let me put it like this. There is an act of God, the Holy Spirit, a divine action that is invisible, non-physical, non-material, invisible, indescribable, infinite, since the one who is going to take on human nature fills the universe and outside of the universe. And above all, it's incomprehensible to us. It's incomprehensible. The way in which the eternal Son of God can exist as a human being without ceasing to be God and without damaging the human nature that he takes. That is beyond our understanding. It's beyond our ability to explain. It's a mystery in the strictest sense, although the mystery has been revealed so that what we can say about it is true, even if we don't understand what we're saying. Even if we don't understand what we're saying. When John says the Word became flesh, we can repeat that. And we can say the eternal Word who was with God, who made everything and made all things, became flesh. We can say that, and it's absolutely true, although we can't understand it. And I'm not here this morning to make you understand it, because I can't. Because only God can understand God. And we're only human, in the strictest sense. The Holy One has been conceived by the Holy Spirit, by the power of the Most High, so that he can be called, in an utterly unique and distinct sense, in the sense of his being, what he is in existence, the Son of God, the Son of the Most High. And only God could do that. That's what we've learned so far, that there is no human aspect to this. This is a work of God, the Holy Spirit, who accomplishes it. We've seen that the Holy Spirit himself is God. We've seen that the one who comes to Mary and tells her this is going to happen is God. We've discovering that the one who's going to be conceived in her womb is God, and the only way that can happen is if there is a divine figure behind it all. It means that Jesus in his human nature has the Holy Spirit as a special anointing that is unprecedented and unrepeatable. He is the superlatively anointed one of God. Well, our reading today takes us a step further from what we've learned so far. It concerns a visitation. Here are two pregnant mothers whose pregnancies have been supernatural works of God. This is their first meeting. One of them knows about the other, that is, Mary knows about Elizabeth. Elizabeth does not know about Mary. At least, she doesn't know what has happened to Mary, nor what was told Mary. One has become pregnant in great old age and in spite of infertility. The other by an act of God creating her child in her womb without any natural human causes. The child of Elizabeth will become the forerunner of the Lord God. Mary is carrying the Lord God in her womb, though she does not know it at the point in which we start our reading for today. Now, the Old Testament contains a whole series of miraculous births. They always come at decisive turning points in the history of the salvation of the world and the history of the salvation of men and women. There's Isaac, the mother of Sarah, Isaac's mother, Sarah, rather. There's Samuel's mother, Hannah. There's the anonymous mother of Samson. Each of these figures were important to the story of Israel. All three of them contributed to Israel's rescue from her enemies by the power and grace of God. So the whole story of those stories and the story of Elizabeth and Mary all teach us that salvation does not come as a result of human will or a husband's decision. It is all of God from beginning to end. Into a hopeless world, God makes a new beginning, a new creation that is not a product of human history, but is a gift from God given into human history. With that in mind then, let's look at the three aspects of the story. First of all, there's the meeting. And in the meeting of these two women, Elizabeth and Mary, there's a coming together of two worlds, the world of the Old Testament and the world of the New Testament. The whole passage has its background, a Hebrew manuscript somewhere in the background that has recorded the memories of some of the people involved in this and predates Luke's release of the material in his gospel. The God of the Bible, unlike the gods of the pagans round about Israel, and unlike the Greek gods and the Roman gods and the pagan gods of Britain and America, the God of the Bible does not have a divine consort, a kind of goddess by his side. Instead, the God of the Bible takes as his bride or as his wife his people. He enters into a covenant relationship that's like a marriage covenant with his people, that is, his corporate people, whether it's Israel or the church. And in the unfolding story of God's relationship with his people, the church or Israel, a number of women figure in particular and have a vital role in the story. So, for example, the Bible begins with Eve. Eve, who is taken from Adam's side. Both Adam and Eve fall into sin. But after the fall, it is Adam who is singled out, and he is presented to us with all of his male progeny, including the men in this room. Adam stands for the sign of death. As in Adam, all die. So in the Bible, the male stands for death, a reminder of Adam's sin. The woman, Eve, is the mother of all the living. And she becomes the sign of life, the bearer of life. She is the badge of hope. Now, I mean all women here, whether they have children or not. The woman in the Bible narrative stands for the bearer of life and the bearer of hope to the world. It's to the woman that the first promise of the gospel is given in Genesis 3:15. And from now on, after the giving of that promise, Eve and all her female progeny, from now on are the keeper of the seal of life and are the antithesis of death. And as I've said, that applies to all women, whether they have children or not. Eve, the mother of all the living, and women as a class bear the sign of life and the promise of hope for the world. And that's the fundamental plank of what the Bible teaches about the role of women. And some of these women, as the story progresses, are great mothers. There's Sarah and Rachel and Hannah and now Elizabeth. These women were fertile. God did a great miracle within them, and they had figures, sons who were important figures in the story of redemption. And each of their stories are pointing us forward to a bigger purpose, a greater purpose that is to come and that now comes to fruition in the birth of John the Baptist and in the arrival of the Messiah. Occasionally, these women take spectacular parts in the story. Deborah, for example, in the book of Judges, Esther, both of whom are judge saviors who act for the covenant people. In the Old Testament, the covenant community, Israel, like the New Testament covenant community, the church, are always, always, without fail, referred to in feminine terms. The church is God's consort. The church is described as a woman, as a virgin, as the beloved, as the wife, as the bride, as the mother of the people of God. The church is our mother. We're born into her. We're washed by her, and we're fed by her, and we're instructed and nourished in our faith by her throughout our life here as Christians. This is a meeting of two worlds. Secondly, the greeting. Mary sets out on her journey with haste, we're told. Immediately. That's the sense of the original. She wastes no time getting the message from the angel that she's going to be pregnant and that this is going to be a work of God. She wastes no time in going to Elizabeth, her relative. Elizabeth, her relative, doesn't know anything that's going on with Mary. Mary's been told by the angel that God has already been at work in her relative's womb and that she is pregnant. And she wastes no time in going. She may have had the conversation with Joseph immediately, but then she heads out on her own to make this journey. It's not an easy journey. But she goes unchaperoned. She goes on her own without protection or supervision. Off she goes in order to see Elizabeth. It's very interesting. It's actually entertaining reading some of the 19th century preachers on this particular story, because you can tell that they're worried as they're telling the story. They're worried not to make too much of the fact that Mary goes off on her own and makes the journey on her own. That's a bit adventurous for 19th century Victorian women, apparently, who are not allowed to do that kind of thing on their own. And she doesn't. The preachers don't want any women in the congregation to get the wrong ideas. But the Holy Spirit apparently has no such qualms. Off she goes. As Martin Bucer, the reformer of Strasbourg and later Cambridge, says, the Blessed Virgin, the chosen vessel of God who is blessed among women, when she heard that Elizabeth was blessed, went out, immediately went out from Nazareth to Judah. These women had something in common, of course. They had the message of the angel. Mary knew that, and she wanted immediately to go and have fellowship with someone to whom the angel had spoken. And when she entered, it says, when she entered the house of Zechariah, she greeted Elizabeth. Don't pour too much into that. There was no kind of religious greeting. It was just, hi, it's me, or whatever it might be. A very informal greeting, a natural greeting given to an elderly relative. And it's the response of John the Baptist that takes center stage here. And what Elizabeth says, I want you to look at two things here. First of all, the baby, we're told, leaped in her womb. Later, we'll be told she leapt with joy. Now, of course, babies move in the womb. Elizabeth's baby was at this point about 6 months, we're told. Movements are common, and if you're a parent for the first time, quite exciting the first time it happens. Exciting enough to get an elbow in your chest in the middle of the night to wake up and to feel the baby moving. I recall. But this was no ordinary movement. This was a movement accompanied by a divine quickening. The Holy Spirit was present in John the Baptist, in the womb. Just as God had said to Jeremiah, before you were in the womb, I called you. And in the womb, I named you. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, we're told in verse 41. She was filled with the Holy Spirit in particular to give the gift of prophecy to her. Because she prophesies, we're told, with a loud voice, with a loud cry. She uttered a loud cry, it says in the King James Version. She is in the grip of divine revelation. She is overflowing with words, like the psalmist says, when you're in the grip of inspiration and you're in the presence of God and the Holy Spirit's quickening you, you are overwhelmed by the revelation that she's received. By the Holy Spirit, Elizabeth was given the revelation to know what Mary didn't know, that within a matter of 4 or 5 days, Mary was pregnant. Now, you don't usually know you're pregnant in the first 4 or 5 days. I speak from experience. You find that out further on. Mary did not know she was pregnant. Elizabeth is given this knowledge and is the first to tell her that she is pregnant, because she greets her immediately as a mother. Not only that, but Elizabeth greets her with words that are familiar to Mary, because they're words that echo the words of the angel to Mary. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. Rejoice, O highly favored one, the angel had said. You are blessed. Now, let me say something about this word blessed. To be blessed does not mean to be happy. Happy signals what you feel. When you're happy, you feel happy. Blessed is something you can know even when you don't feel happy. To be blessed in the Bible refers to a person's state, whether or not they're happy or not. You're blessed when the favor of God rests upon you, when the Lord God delights in you. And Elizabeth recognizes that Mary is in that state of favor with God, that God delights in her. And she offers this prophetic word to Mary. Mary, of all the women in the world, you are the most blessed. And I want you to notice, and the Geneva Bible here is much clearer in the meaning of these words than the ESV is. Blessed art thou among women because, what makes you blessed? Because the fruit of thy womb is blessed. Mary is full of grace because her womb is full of Jesus. Mary's blessedness rises out of Jesus' presence. Now remember, at this stage, Jesus would be 4 or 5 days within her womb. But Elizabeth is given the prophetic insight into Mary's status. And she immediately greets Mary as a mother. Notice that. Within a couple of days of conception, she is greeted as a mother. That has all kinds of ramifications, doesn't it, for our view of babies in the womb. But that's something for another time. Elizabeth has given this prophetic insight into her status, greets her as a mother, and says she is blessed because of the Blessed One that is within her. And let there be no doubting who that Blessed One is. He is the one who later on in the New Testament is described as God over all, blessed forever. That is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. God over all, blessed forever. Mary is blessed because of the Blessed One who indwells within her. And she goes on to say this, "Why has it been granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" Martin Luther says, "The Holy Spirit spoke to her heart and told her why this child had come, that he might redeem the human race, and she felt her unworthiness. Confronted by God's obvious work in her and in Mary, her relative, for her salvation." She is overwhelmed by that. But I want you to notice more closely the words that she uses here. "Why is it granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" She's saying that she felt very privileged, specially privileged, to have Mary in her home. Why? Because of the presence of Mary, Mary's son. By the Holy Spirit, in a prophetic position, she perceives that Mary is blessed among women because the fruit of her womb is the Blessed One, because that child is the Lord himself. In other words, Elizabeth becomes the first human being to proclaim the incarnation. Just as another woman, Mary Magdalene, would become the first person to proclaim the resurrection. She proclaims the incarnation by the way she speaks to Mary, "the mother of my Lord." She's echoing the language, channeling the language, we might say, of Psalm 110. And in that psalm, we have the prophet, David the prophet, speaking prophetically about the one who is coming. And he says, "The Lord said to my Lord," and that's the language that she's using there, "the mother of my Lord," the one that David is speaking about, the one who is to come, who shares the status of the God of Israel. Now, when Gabriel had come to Mary, you remember, he had assured her that the Lord was with her. This is another point of familiarity between what Gabriel said to Mary on her own and was unknown to anybody else, and now the words of Elizabeth. Elizabeth is using similar language to signal that this is an authentic word that I'm speaking to you. It's the word of God that she's speaking to Mary. Gabriel had said to Mary, "The Lord is with you." Now Elizabeth says to Mary, "The Lord is within you." The Lord is within you. You're already pregnant, Mary. God has done this miracle. But I want you to notice the language that Elizabeth uses. This word Lord. When God revealed himself to Israel, to Moses, he revealed his name, his own secret name, Yahweh. The Jewish people did not like and still do not like to use that name, and so they prefer another name, another word, to signal the presence of that name, Yahweh, and that's the word Adonai, which we translate as Lord. So when she uses the word, "my Lord," she's echoing Psalm 110. She's speaking about Yahweh, that is Adonai, that is the God of Israel himself. And she's saying to Mary, "Mary, you are the mother of Adonai. You're the mother of Yahweh. No wonder you are blessed because of the Blessed One who is in your womb." She's overwhelmed. She feels this has been granted to her. She doesn't deserve this. She understands that she and the child in her womb, like the rest of us, are children of wrath and in need of salvation. But Mary's boy is the blessed. He is the Lord God. He is the Savior. One scholar put it like this: Elizabeth was the first to articulate the doctrinal truth of the incarnation in a way that is striking, concise, and memorable, a doctrinal soundbite. That is, to predicate of God what pertains to being human. Now, that's mind-blowing. It may not blow your mind, but it's mind-blowing if you consider it for a moment. To predicate of the Creator something that belongs to the creature. To predicate of God what belongs to human. To predicate of the Son what belongs to a human child. Look closely at this phrase. The mother of my Lord. What does she mean by the Lord? She means the Lord God who is invisible, ineffable, infinite, that cannot be located. You can't locate God anywhere because God is everywhere. When we say invisible, we mean invisible. He's not just like a ghost that is a kind of invisible entity, but there's something there, something there. No, there's nothing there. There is nothing you can put your hand on, nothing you can imagine. There is nothing. It's invisible. God is not made up of stuff. That's why we say about God that the first thing you must learn about the Christian God is He is incomprehensible. There is nothing in created reality that you can point at and say, God's like that, in an absolute sense. That's what he's saying. That's what she's saying. This Lord God can't be born because he's eternal. This Lord God doesn't have body parts. So when she says that the child in her womb is the Lord God, she is actively giving Mary, and by the way, at the very same time as he is in her womb, he is actively giving Mary and Elizabeth and us life and breath and existence. But you see what Mary calls her? Sorry, Elizabeth calls Mary. The mother of my Lord. By calling her the mother of my Lord, it means the Lord must have come to exist as a man. For only as a man can the Lord be born of a woman. Only as human can you be born of a woman. And in this succinct, brief statement, she sums up the entirety of the theology of the incarnation. She's telling us that the boy Mary carries is in some way a union of God and man, the divine and human. We don't understand this union. It's called in theology the hypostatic union. It's both mysterious and it's incomprehensible to us. We can in no way understand it. It's beyond our ability. But nonetheless, here it is. Here's how one theologian puts it. This means that the Son of Mary is in his being, ontologically is the word he uses, in his very existence, truly the Lord God. Secondly, Mary's Son is ontologically, in his existence, truly human. And thirdly, Mary's truly human Son, in his very existence, truly is the Lord God. For Elizabeth, Mary's Son truly is the Lord God who truly exists as truly human. That's why her child is leaping for joy. It's a signal of her child being full of the Holy Spirit and being in the presence of the Lord. But we can say more. Both the one in her belly, who is the Lord, and the one who had spoken to her. You know, see that reference, what was spoken to her from the Lord in verse 45. Both the one in her belly, who is the Lord, and the one who had spoken to her about it, is God. Elizabeth is not suggesting there are two gods. She is an Orthodox Jewess who believes that there's only one simple, single, stable God. But she's saying the one who spoke to you was the Lord. The one who's within you is the Lord. Later on, as we read the Gospels, we discover that the one who spoke to her was the Father. The one within her is God the Son. And the one who did the wonderful miracle is God the Holy Spirit. She is introducing us to the doctrine of the Incarnation and to the doctrine of the Trinity, which is why one theologian, very conservative theologian, says Elizabeth should be considered the first doctor of the church for teaching us all this stuff. And perhaps Mary Magdalene qualifies to be the second doctor of the church for teaching us about the resurrection. Elizabeth announces Christ as Lord and Mary to be his mother. And then lastly, and briefly, the blessing. Blessed is she, the believed. That's Mary. Mary believed and is therefore blessed. She's a believer. She is a woman of faith, period. These words are in line with Jesus' words later. Blessed are those who, though not seeing, are yet believing. Mary had acted with haste because she believed the promise. She'd gone to see her relative because she'd heard about the relative's miracle. She had gone to tell them the relative. She didn't get a chance to tell her relative, Elizabeth, because her relative, Elizabeth, under the Holy Spirit, recognizes immediately what Mary hasn't yet discovered. So she's acting in faith. She is a believer. The King James Version captures this better, I think, than our English Standard Version here. Blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of these things. It's not that she's believed these things. She's believed God. And these things are going to happen to her as God told her. There'll be a fulfillment. In fact, the conception's already occurred. The rest of it will all be fulfilled as well, as time passes. Mary was blessed because she believed in Christ. Elizabeth's prophecy must have been a great confirmation and encouragement. Can you imagine? Mary's probably spoken to Joseph. She's carrying this secret. And Elizabeth knows it, speaks of it openly. Being able to talk about it. Can you imagine carrying a secret like this and not being able to talk to anybody who understands? But Elizabeth understands. These women found in each other soulmates. They found in each other for the next 3 months. She stays 3 months with Elizabeth. And they're building each other up in their faith. They're encouraging each other in the faith. Because for both of them, what has happened to them is incomprehensible. There is no explanation. But they meet with each other, they speak to each other, they encourage one another in their faith because they've learned not to try to carry the burden alone. You know, Elizabeth and Mary especially, stands out in the story as an example of what a Christian should be. She's the first Christian. Going to Elizabeth makes Elizabeth the second Christian, the first, second believer in the incarnate Lord Jesus Christ. And together in that little meeting that they have, they represent the first church, first community of believers. Jesus is present there with them as they talk. He is present in their company as they speak, as they do things from day to day that they would do in Elizabeth's home. They're believers, and Christ is present. And what's feeding them is the Word of God. You can see that when you hear Mary pray, and you listen to Zechariah's prophecy, and Mary's Magnificat. She just bursts into song, and we don't have time. I was out of my mind when I thought I could cover it as well as what I'm covering this morning. But they're laced with Scripture. These women are full of the Bible. They're full of Scripture. And the fellowship that they had was sweet. And at the heart of their fellowship, at the heart of their relationship, is that these women, both these women, believed that Jesus, the human baby that Mary was carrying, Jesus, was Lord. They believed that Jesus was the Lord God. And that's what it means to be a Christian. To be a Christian is to believe what those women believed. It's to follow Mary's lead. No one can say Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Spirit. Elizabeth illustrates that principle. No one can say Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit enters our lives and enables us to say what Elizabeth said about Mary's baby. And one day every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Blessed is she that believed. Maybe you're here this morning and you struggle with your faith. Maybe you're here this morning and you're struggling with this talk of incarnation. Maybe you struggle with the whole idea of Mary's baby. I don't know. But we're urged by this passage to think about Mary, the Blessed Virgin herself. She's flesh and blood. She's just a girl. But she believed God without the evidence. She kept believing it without losing her faith, without losing her nerve, without losing her humility, without losing her sanity. All of those things were at risk for Mary. This was a huge thing to happen. I was going to say to a simple peasant girl, but there's nothing simple or peasant-like about Mary. God in His grace enabled her to believe the promise, and by believing the promise, she keeps her faith, her nerve, her humility, and her sanity. We mustn't hesitate to praise God for this blessed woman, because the Bible tells us to. She is a mother to the church, the mother of our Lord. We are members of the body of Christ. She is a mother, and as mothers in Israel were, an example to all Israel of what faith and love and action look like. She is our sister in Christ, because we, like her, belong to the family of Jesus. Who are my mother and my brothers? Those that do the will of my Father in heaven, they are my mother and my sisters and my brothers. And she is an example of faith. Elizabeth honors Christ when, according to His human nature, He is indetectable in Mary's womb. How much more should we honor Christ now that we know that He has come into the world and has died for us and risen again, that He now lives and reigns and intercedes on our behalf in the Father's presence? How much more should we not honor Christ, as Mary immediately goes on to do in her song, and sets the scene for us, gives us the example of honoring Jesus as her Savior, as her Lord, as the one who is mighty, who has done great things for her and who will do great things for us. At Christmas time is Jesus time. And Mary would want us to worship Jesus. She would want us to honor Him. And she would rejoice if we were able to say, perhaps one of you, for the very first time in your life, Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Father, will You bless Your word, and will You make it live to us? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.